well with this for very good reason. We are very flexible, we can re-document, we can cut and paste, but we also have other issues that should come later. So in this case, our first project is my MP.
Yay.
My MP is a project we work in Indonesia, it's a motor education program. Mm. Essentially, we have volunteers that are working with us to cut source information on MP, because MP's information are all around. If you're lucky, we can find it on the internet, blogs, Twitter, Facebook, and that, but we don't have a central place. We need help. And second, only Malaysia guys have been working on motor education for a long time, for around a year. So these guys are the best help we can find. Working with them, awesome. Also, this guy is run on clone, FYI. Whoops! What just happened? Okay, it's crowd computing for the win. So what happened is we managed to get a lot of information out. So clone, there is no hard use, not an issue. We did get quite like half of the information out between 2 months, 3 months of launching my MP. So I said not that bad. So that comes this the problem again. There is MP that I would say no profile. So if you want to find the information online, you need to do serious research. That's where things come help. Because the whole idea of crowdsourcing is that I do a little bit of small tasks, maybe a small task and bring the information. Once the information gets a lot harder, then you take it for serious research work. You are not paid for this. So we just we end up having volunteer leave, which actually I said. So currently my MP coming from over around 50-20 people to around 4 people. And because we have half of the MP that do not have information beyond phone number and email, assuming that we need to call them up, there's no receive mail, there's no replies, yada yada yada. A lot of issue. As I said, this guy is pretty low profile, which might be a good or bad thing. So of course we have information, we can ask for it. SSN got good data, we need to buy from them. We need to go fast. Worst case, well, welcome to the information black hole. Well, we might find something in between, but we need to help. How many minutes? Can't see.
Seven.
Thank you. So, after we run through our data collection, a scraper, a crowdsource, we need to convert it. Now, they just convert it into a nice file format. This is running from the CIBB scraper. The output is JSON. As you can see, it's actually a nested JSON for those that's not technical, hard to put into Excel. So, what do we do? We run through a script and convert it into CSV. Okay, let's believe this is CSV. I already uploaded it on Google Fusion Table. Why do you want to convert, process the data in a way? Two reasons. One, data is dirty. Some of this data is via data entry. Error side.
Feel icky, it's like doubting yourself, self-hatred, self-doubt, it's like, I can't do it. In the moment, given what you've intended for the future, if you're feeling a negative emotion, in that moment, whatever you're thinking, doing, or saying will not take you where you want to go. So, I hope you guys understand that and ask me questions more about it later, and there's a ton more to read about. So when we use meditation to cultivate mindfulness, we can more fully utilize the law of attraction to create exactly what we want, to create companies that matter, to create things that add value to people's lives and change the world. That's what wakes me up. That's why I came to work every single day here at MindUp, perfect place for me to do that. I'm running out of time, so these are just some of the benefits. The benefits are vast. You can Google the benefits of meditation. Scientifically proven, hundreds of years people have been doing this. Buddha was here 3,500 years ago. Okay, meditation's gonna stick around. So it's truly the evolution of the human mind and the ability to create and make change in the world. So further reading, Powered Now by Eckhart Tolle, extremely famous best-selling author. The Autobiography of Yogi, which is Jobs' only book on his iPad, The Law of Attraction. It's an easy name by Esther Hicks. You can come and ask me about these if you want, no problem. And if you are interested, if you you want to hear more about this in the future, you can go to startmeditation.com. It's just a landing page. I don't know if people are interested or not. Okay, so if you are interested in it, go there and check it out. There's nothing there, but it's a launch out page. I gotta support my other startups right here. So this is my personal Facebook, okay? Personally, you can add me as a friend, and you can ask me any questions through message.
Awesome. Meditation group every day 6 p.m. occupying lovely spaces here. And now here I would like to grab. Sorry, I'm not going to grab you physically.
Assuming would like to be grabbed by you.
Our Q&A session here. I want to invite back all our four speakers so that you can applaud them or throw your shoes at them.
But all the shoes are outside.
Please give a round of applause if you enjoy your seminar. So here's the official photographer. So here's where I basically say, like, you know, if you want to leave now, you can leave now. No hard feelings. I still like you. Not as much. And here's where you get to ask any questions to all of them. How moderate the stupid questions or the smart questions.
So, Taran, is there like any videos for somebody to learn about meditation, like on YouTube? Do you have like any author or do such stuff, like do it online, teaching?
Yeah, there are lots of resources online. There are all sorts of types of meditation you can learn for different purposes. The autobiography of a yogi, the organization that he started and founded will provide really, really good meditation lessons. The meditation that I practice every day is literally for enlightenment. So, just so you know, I'm very transparent about it. I don't meditate for productivity, for good health, for any of these other reasons. I meditate for the direct realization of God in my life. So that's why I meditate, and that's what Paramahansa Yogananda will advocate for meditation. There are all sorts of other meditation techniques and places. There's something called the relaxation response, which is a very secular meditation technique, which will tell you simply how to calm yourself and go deep within to the alpha state of mind and enjoy the benefits of meditation just the same as anyone else. So there are all sorts of resources. You can also go to Theron.me, my personal page over here, my blog or whatever. It's my own website, and I do have meditations on there. But I'm more excited to make meditations about startups. If you go to the other website, tell me to do it. So, yes. Yes.
Thank you.
Cool. I personally meditate for relaxation every morning. But the four kids, I don't sleep. It's funny, but I sleep like half an hour a day.
Yeah.
And I'm like,
yeah, so about the Amazon Web Services, are you concerned with the any locking? Like, how much are you changing your software to, like, the Amazon? So if you wanted to change to, like, Cloud Foundry or some other supply description, how concerned are you about that?
It's a really good question. It's something which we've considered each time we adopt a service, what our get out is. I guess we're kind of fortunate at the moment that we're in a bit of a halfway house between running our own stuff and running stuff at AWS that we have to build into both environments. So it's the same with things like DynamoDB. The programmer in me thinks, wow, that looks fantastic, love to have a go with that, play with it. The CIO in me has to say, well, hang on, you know, how do we justify locking ourselves into that? And even things, I mean, you know, even if you were still using AWS in the future, if you're tying all of your environments in there, your dev environments and everything else, the only place you can run it is in AWS, it could cause some real problems. So yeah, it's definitely a concern with some of the services. What's also nice about AWS is a lot of their APIs for provisioning have kind of become big after standards. So a lot of other companies use very similar or the same APIs. So you don't lock yourself in quite so much with those kind of provisioning APIs.
So, when you're using S3 for CDN, how do you compare that to using Akamai? That's the one I'm more familiar with from a CDN point of view.
So Akamai, we use a particular product of theirs called Dynamic Site Accelerator. So that's basically routing all of the dynamic pages through their CDN back to our origin servers. And they do various kind of things at the protocol level to optimize that and optimize the routing. Amazon doesn't yet support that. They have started doing some dynamic stuff recently, but there's still quite a few missing pieces. They can't do the post requests, for example, through that, which is a very big downside for us. So more like that, our dynamic stuff, we're still using Akamai. But the static stuff, I'm very happy with CalFrom. And say it's a fraction of the price of Akamai.
So the price point is
The price is, yeah, I mean, look, Akamai is a fantastic service, and particularly if you're working in countries like Indonesia, where the internet infrastructure is less advanced than say, Malaysia and Singapore and Hong Kong, then there's probably a fair bit of added benefit. But, you know, if you're accessing a POP in Singapore from Malaysia, the latency is so low that it's not really an issue. And running up to that is more than good.
I'm going to pretend that
I have a question about AWS thing. Are you using, I'm not sure if you can answer this, but are you using multi-region? And if you are using it, how are you handling the balancing between regions? Like, I assume Amazon has something for this already.
Multi-region, multi-AZ is kind of an interesting topic. And I've had multiple debates with people on Twitter about it in the past. So for me, generally, multi-AZ is good enough. The chances of a full region outage are, well, I mean, this history show may happen.
Any storm.
Any storm. I know, I always take the pragmatic view of, look, there will be outages wherever you are. If you're running your own stuff, you're going to have an outage. And you have to say, well, are my people as good as or better than people at Amazon? You know, at what point is it economic to keep pushing for so many nines in your uptime? And at which point is it just, okay, we accept that we might have some outages and that we will be able to deal with those in an appropriate way. I mean, fingers crossed, Southeast Asia, Singapore, AWS has not had any issues yet. they always seem to happen in the US East. My theory is, you know, that's where they do a lot of their testing, a lot of their new stuff happens there. It's always their largest. So if you're in the US East, you're more at risk. But that doesn't mean that Singapore is not going to have an outage.
US East is also the highest concentration of Amazon technologies.
It was the first one, so that's where everyone
is at. Yeah, absolutely. But for us in this region, Singapore, so far, touch wood, has been.
Same
But yeah, multi-region, I guess, is possible, but very hard to do properly.
I have a follow-up question. So recently, this new PaaS app form is doing multi-region. So you just click a button, and it just ships your app to either Southeast Asia or US or anywhere. So wouldn't that be beneficial in the case? Let's say something goes down.
Can you repeat the question?
So which does platform as a service, which does multi-region. Look, I haven't had experience with that one directly. My experience of it is the hard part is getting data synchronization right, particularly if you're running in a multi-master setup, that you're adding a lot of complexity. And it's actually something we looked at as we were moving across from our own kit to AWS, was how do we do that? Do we run it out of two places simultaneously, or do we just move some and leave others? And we decided on the latter, because running out of two places simultaneously just added so much extra complexity in so many more places that you break it, that it just didn't seem worthwhile doing. So I don't know how they handled it, but those kinds of things where you're doing a lot of writes in two places can start to get tricky.
Sorry, not AWS.
sorry.
You said you just started using auto-scaling, so I was skeptical about that because it could auto-scale up, but it didn't scale back down. Is it still like that, or does it scale back down itself?
It does scale back down,
okay.
But my advice would be to
not
to
use that.
I mean, it's absolutely, of course, in AWS's best interests.
Just in case.
So we do keep a monitor out on how many instances we're running. So we're keeping track of that. And you know, we're running other services, things like New Relic, which are on a per instance basis.
Yeah.
So they can
give you more if you get more instances.
If we're doing more.
I was going to say, how do you quickly rebuild your machines? What technology are you using? Just a whole bunch of shell scripts or puppets?
We're using Puppet for the infrastructure side. And then that's...
not slaves in Indonesia.
So we're using Puppet for the infrastructure, and for the code we've kind of knocked up a bit of a system using Capistrano and Jenkins to pull the code out of Git and to deploy it to the web machines.
Do you have like a one-time build type thing or that you test often enough? Or?
Yeah, relatively often. But it's also, so the staging environment and production environment are identical there.
Oh.
So
I had a question for Swingman. In the UK, the Guardian newspaper collects a lot of data about government. So I'm thinking the Star in Malaysia seems to be a good popular paper. Do they? I mean, surely they collect lots of information about government, stuff they do, and you could query it. Do you get stuff from them?
The long answer and the short answer. The long answer is somebody wrote a script for that. The short, and I forget to run it. It's not updated. It's full text. You do not have the context, that's the first one. It's a full text thing, so you need to find the right keyword. So the best way for it is to have somebody to actually read it, tag it.
I mean, which is the best newspaper for actually collecting data on?
So what we learned from that project is none. Because it's either very government centric or very partisan. So it's not, so in the end of the day, we grab both. And we just do from there. So the first rule we have is that don't trust the data, analyze and track and bring down.
Actually, the data is available. It's just that like a lot of the agencies and stuff, they roll their own, and it's worth money. So obviously, like if you're a marketing person, you can buy the data. So
yes.
Obviously, you're not into the buying thing.
Without money, that's a
and I don't know, like the buying of the data, obviously it comes with like terms and stuff. You can't make it open and shit like that, obviously.
I can't tell you guys. I need to investigate that
further.
What's the money? And also, there's another thing. The Guardian guys, they are one of those guys that actually push data-driven journalism. So they actually collect data, journalists. We have been checking for sources for this as well. Bloomberg surprisingly have very good information for a machine company.
And also, is there like a version of WikiLeaks in Malaysia? Has there any high-profile leaks from government, or no one has bothered to leak?
No.
I mean, there were previous leaks by
From Malaysia, but from the US.
Yeah, it's nothing really significant. It's more, if you read it, it seems very gossipy. It's like talking about this person and that person. Yeah.
And also, it tend to be, the leaks tend to be more important for diplomatic affairs, not something, somebody.
Yeah.
Not somebody on the ground. So, we say we answer, we need to spend time on this, but that's our focus now. We should have, but we also need more help.
Yeah, two questions on the same topic.
Yeah.
One, do you have any legal issues with like the websites basically having copyrights? Like if I were to scrape my property, you might not be so
happy.
You know, that kind of stuff. All right.
Okay. There's two answers for it. If it's a government website, we believe it is our right as a taxpayer to get the information we want. If it's on the government website, because it's posted with our tax money. If it is on a private company site, yeah, we need to be careful about that. On copyright, because it is not something that we actually pay. So it is owned by private individuals. So we are breaking the law.
Second question, have you
scraped Bank Negara? Bank Negara is presenting a good information, but it's not our focus now. Because our focus now is on Parliament, because we have signed the opening Parliament declaration, which is actually an international initiative with Sunlight Foundation and Open Knowledge Foundation to actually open up the Parliament of each country. Congress, Parliament, whatever, on this to make the information more easily available, and that's the PR and whatnot. So that's why our focus is on MP, Parliament, and whatnot. I mean, we used to have that, but if we have more people to do that, we will learn it. But unfortunately, we have that much more people.
I'm kind of curious, like, because the two of you are here, and one is sucking data, one has a lot of data.
So,
would bother you if streaming scrapes iProperty for location-based stuff, property data, as well to aggregate that into some sort of information?
Average price of houses.
You know, because you can do like matrixing out and stuff and find out, like, because he's into a problem with boundary data and stuff like that. So I'm just curious, like, as a commercial enterprise, what's your stand in terms of open data and contributing data? I'm not going to pay you my heart. I'm just curious, what is the official company stance as well?
Official company stance on the site
right now,
without checking. I think it was interesting what you were saying about spraying my property, is that certainly from my understanding, and this is me speaking as me, not as for my company, is that facts cannot be copyrighted. So something like a house has three bedrooms and two bathrooms, and it's on this street, is not copyrighted. That's a fact. It exists. Once you get into things like the photographs of that house, the description, those kinds of things, that's copyrighted, and you can't scrape that. For me as a CIO, I mean, of course, we do keep an eye out for scrapers and so on. We tend to block them, and the reason we block them is more to do with abuse of resources and taking up rather than any particular problem, because a lot of that information is available to multiple sources as well, and of course for our advertisers, they want their listings to be as widely available as possible. Certainly we are very interested in contributing those kind of things if there's good causes that we can.
Can I add on top of that? Certain information is not copyrighted, but it's official secret.
So does iProperty have any API for accessing, to find out what's the average price of stuff? Was it a trade secret? I'm very naive.
It certainly we're building a lot of APIs at the moment, and it's certainly our intention to start opening those up again and try to involve the developer community more in building interesting things based on that.
Because that's literally on the gold mine of information.
should have just waiting to be exploited.
Because if the main issue with scraping is resources, you can make a public API and put it on like, use this server, we know like here's the maximum cost we're gonna have.
Yeah.
So we get the data without having to do the manual scraping.
And then if you're gonna suck more, I'm gonna charge you something.
Yeah.
I believe that a outside agency should actually do that, company contribute data. But open data and open government in general is very new down here.
Yeah.
I'll just like to add that the Parliament website actually has a copyright protection.
Yeah, it's copyright protection, but you also pay the taxpayer.
Yeah.
I pay tax, FYI.
No,
so,
although it's copyright protection, but like the it's actually facts, so they can't hide it.
I just want to quickly comment. You guys might have a solution to this problem. I did some work for a vet, and they have a big database, MySQL 9 from Microsoft. It's got like millions of records about pet health, you know, what they died of and things like that. And there's so much information there, it's absolutely nuts.
Yes.
But the thing is, it's like, oh, we don't have time to data mine it or figure it out because we're just trying to run this vet. And the 10 or 12 branches of it. If someone could write a program to sort of, you know, leech onto that MySQL server, you know, rip out all the personal details of the pet owners, and, you know, maybe anonymize the data so the pets, well, I mean, you can identify pets, for Christ's sake. And then have an API. This sort of, I wanted to sort of have that layer and offer that and then, you know, go to the local university and say, hey, check out this data. There's, you know, 10 years of millions of pets here. You could figure out what pets are dying of and make them live longer.
Oh, yeah. I got two answers for that. My current project, I kind of scraped them. It's actually a data dump site. Currently, it's allowing CSV and JSON upload and convert it into API. No querying, sorry. You can query by ID though.
No querying.
No querying. Data dumping.
So someone needs to do something on the server side where we remove personal information you can use SQL queries on the database.
Yeah. So
as long as you can prove that you're not going to make the MySQL server fall over or something.
Yeah, so let's continue on that. There's one project at the data dump site. The second thing is you need to write a specific script because each data is very different. Even from Parliament, it's one set of database, the structure is very different. CIDB, another data set, the number is also very different. CIDB has 300,000 rows of records, companies, which actually crashes my computer if I ever need to compress it and dump it in the database.
It's still
RSNX. And also for Parliament, we've got like 222 MPs, very small numbers of it, pretty small. So the data is very different, the amount is very different. We need a specific script for it, which is why scripting language is awesome. We use it instead of Java or whatnot. So we can write small script to actually extract data out and put it inside the library.
Assuming we're a data coal miner.